Let's consider a behavior model called the theory of planned behavior. This theory actually started as what we call the theory of reasoned action, which was developed and published in 1980, and it was developed to predict individuals' intention to engage in a behavior at specific times and places. This theory was intended to explain all behaviors over which people have the ability to exert self-control. The key component to this model is behavior intent. Behavioral intentions are influenced by attitude about the likelihood of the behavior we have, the expected outcomes, and the subjective evaluation of the risks and benefits. So this theory suggests that our intention and how strong our intention to perform the behavior is, that will influence whether or not we participate in the behavior. As I indicated, this started out as the theory of planned behavior, but it was successfully adapted to now be the theory of planned behavior. And it has been used successfully to predict and explain a lot of behaviors such as smoking, drinking, health services utilization, substance abuse, and other things. The theory of planned behavior states that behavioral achievement depends on both motivation, which is intention, and the ability to control our behaviors. So in other words, we might have the intention to do something, but if we feel we don't have the control over our behaviors to actually do it, then the likelihood that we will practice a behavior is low. It distinguishes between three types of beliefs: behavioral, normative, and control. And so with this theory, there are three constructs. We talked about constructs, and those are the main components of a theory. And in truth, those are the things that you can measure. So with the theory of planned behavior, we have first the constructive attitude. This refers to the degree to which a person has a favorable or unfavorable evaluation of the behavior of interest. So it entails a person considering the outcomes of performing the behavior, the value that they have towards that, the behavior outcomes, whether they think it's a positive or a negative, those kinds of assessments. So the first thing is our attitude towards the behavior. The second construct looks at the subjective norm, and that refers to whether or not we believe people that are important to us want us to perform the behavior. So this refers to whether most people approve or disapprove of the behavior. It could be a peer group, it could be people that are important to us, but our belief as to whether or not those people feel it is important for us to engage in the behavior. The third construct is perceived behavioral control, and this refers to a person's perception of the ease or difficulty of performing the behavior of interest. So it can vary across situations, and this results in a person having a varying perception of their control over the behavior depending upon the situation. And this is the construct that was added later. So it created a shift from the theory of reasoned action to the theory of planned behavior. So to review, the three constructs for the theory of planned behavior are attitude. So that's the degree that a person favors the behavior of interest. Subjective norm, person's perception of whether peer groups approve of the behavior. And when we say peer groups, it could also be someone that's important and significant, such as a parent or partner, maybe the children. So it's people that are important to us. Do they value our participation in the behavior? And then perceived control, that's a person's perception of if the behavior is easy or difficult. Structurally, it looks like this. So on the top you see here are the attitudes towards the behavior, and these are influenced by our behavioral beliefs. Subjective norm, which are controlled and depend upon our normative beliefs. And then perceived control, and that will be influenced by our belief as to whether or not the behavior is hard or easy. And all of these will influence our intention, our intention to participate in the behavior. And if this is high, if you have a high intention, then the behavior will probably be practiced. If the intention is low, chances are you're not going to participate in the behavior. So for an example, we have surveillance data that shows young, acculturated Hispanic women are more likely to get pap tests than those who are older and less acculturated. A health department decides to implement a cervical cancer screening program targeting older Hispanic women. In planning the campaign, practitioners want to conduct a survey to learn what beliefs, attitudes, and intentions there are in this population associated with seeking a pap test. So what do they do to collect this information? They design a survey. So the survey is to gauge when the women received their last pap test. So that would be their existing behavior pattern. How likely they are to seek a pap test. That would indicate their intention. Attitudes about getting a pap test. That would indicate their attitude. Whether or not most people who are important to me would want me to get a pap test, and that would indicate subjective norm, and whether or not getting a pap test is something under my behavioral control. So the department will compare the survey data about who has and has not received a pap test to identify beliefs, attitudes, and intentions that predict seeking one. In this example, you could use the data you collect from the survey to do several things. Because you have all of the constructs, the behavior, which is the outcome, the intention, which is linked to the behavior, and then the three constructs, what you could do is find out the women that get PAPs, what are their attitudes, what are their subjective norms, and what is their perceived behavioral control, so you could actually test this theory. If you find women that have high perceived behavioral control are the ones that are participating and getting PAPs, that supports that construct. Likewise, you could use the survey to find out where that there are barriers to women getting PAP tests. Maybe they feel that their significant others don't care if they get a PAP test and the subjective norm is low. Maybe what you could do is have an intervention where you bring significant others into the equation and teach them about the importance of getting a PAP in terms of reducing their risk of cervical cancer, and then they could encourage the women to get PAPs. Also, their attitude might be either that it doesn't help screen out for disease, or just a PAP is an uncomfortable test. So there might be things that we can do to change the attitude. And then perceived behavioral control. Are there things that we can do to change a woman's perception that they have control over getting a pap smear? So these are things that we do in public health and ways that we use theories. In the module, there is a worksheet related to the theory of planned behavior. Please complete it related to this sample and bring it to class and we'll discuss.